Welcome back to Giant Monster Games. Today, we're doing something different by building some terrain for wargaming, specifically these road dividers, which are going to be used for low cover or cover if you are playing games such as Infinity, Warhammer Kill Team, or Marvel Crisis Protocol. Let's jump straight in with the design process. For me, I like to sketch out what I want to do so I have an idea of where I'm going and what my end objective is trying to accomplish. You get the idea of what we're going to be building, so let's just jump straight in with the actual foam. Foam-wise, we're going to be using this packing foam or pill foam. I have already went ahead and laid out what our pieces are going to look like in their exact size and shape, and then we're going to cut them out with a ruler and an X-Acto knife. For the size of the pieces, we're going to be going with two different lengths. We're going to be going with 1 inch high and 2 inches long for the small ones, and 1 inches high and 4 inches long for the long ones. Both of these are also going to be half inch, which is the thickness of the foam. I'm not actually cutting that down any further. Now, one thing I want to say for this step and all of the steps moving forward, you need to have a razor sharp knife. Literally put a new blade in if you need to, because you should not be ripping this foam apart. You should be cutting it at this stage. There is going to become a point where we're going to want to rip it apart, but if you don't have a sharp blade, you're going to make your life miserable and have little pieces of foam everywhere in your house. So let's do that. Now, before we go too much farther, I want to answer a question, which is, Adrian, why are you using this foam rather than expanded polystyrene, which is way easier to work with when you're building stuff such as what we're working on today? The short answer is because I got a bunch of new appliances for Christmas, and now I have a ton of this stuff just begging to be crafted with. And if you know what you're doing, and if you're doing the right kind of project, this stuff is actually really good. We're doing a concrete project, and this stuff is really good when you're doing stuff that's supposed to look like concrete. Also, if you have a sharp knife and you know what you're doing, you know how you're building with it, it's actually not that hard to build with, and I just kind of want to show that to people out there that have this kind of foam rather than expanded polystyrene. The next step before we get too much into cutting and shaping this foam is we need to make sure that it's not going to fall over every single time you touch it. We're going to do this by putting a nice drizzling of nails on it. What we are going to do is cut a channel in the bottom of the foam and then hot glue a nail in the bottom, making sure that it is flush so it's not going to disrupt it actually sitting on the table, so it is bottom weighted. And as you can see, it's hard to knock over now. Once that step is done, we're going to be cutting these into their final shape. So it's going to be an upside down funnel, and using an extremely sharp knife, we're going to cut a very shallow depth in the face of the piece. And then from the top, we're going to be cutting off a tiny little piece, probably a quarter inch. We just need to make it a little bit thinner, otherwise it's not going to look like a funnel. Be super careful with this. This is like the most dangerous part of the whole thing. Take your time, cut it properly, don't cut your fingers off. Once you finish this, do the same thing on the other side. And then let's cut the bevel, which again, being careful, cut at an angle so you're going from the point, which is the thinnest where you've just cut to, all the way down to the fat outside wedge. So it looks like a funnel. Once it is done, it's gonna look something like this. And as you can guess, if you're doing a two wide piece, it looks the exact same, it's just twice as long. Now, to make these look like they are two separate blocks that are stuck together rather than one extremely long block, you're gonna take your knife and you're gonna cut a thin little channel all the way around the halfway point between the two. As you can see, I've marked it with a black marker, and I'm just taking my knife and oh so gently slicing out that center piece so it looks like we have two blocks. Next, we get to do the fun part of the build. We're gonna take a pen and we're gonna punch a couple holes through the front of this thing just so it looks more like our design, and then we're gonna take that pen and we're going to rip apart parts of our blocks. This is gonna make it look like the block is actually damaged, so it's been shot with a gun or a car's crashed into it or whatever you want. Maybe it's just degrading in general. So go ham, go crazy as much as you want. This is gonna make it look way cool once we get to the next step, which is gonna get very messy. We're gonna be using drywall filler to fill in a lot of the little cracks and kind of smooth out all of those really hard edges that we just ripped into our foam, so it looks like actual concrete rather than pill foam. That's just our objective, right? So do this, use a little bit of water to help to smooth out these things here, because this can get really sticky and tacky really quickly. After it has dried though, we are going to sand it down, just do a quick little light sanding. At this time you can actually bevel some of the edges on the top of the piece if you want. This is the time where we can polish the piece before we start painting. To start off with, we are using the tried and true method, which has been shown by many crafters, which is black paint mixed with Mod Podge. Yes, this is going to act as our base coat and also a sealer for our drywall compound, because we do actually want to make sure that no water is going to get into it and then make it all soggy and do all kinds of weird stuff. Once we have primed everything and everything is now nice and dry, we can start with the dry brushing. I'm going to be doing a very heavy dry brush on everything, so it's more of like a overbrush, I guess you could say, rather than an actual dry brush. We're going to be working this up into multiple different layers. I'm doing three different colors, and one of the things I'm trying with this is instead of just using straight gray, so black and white mixed, I'm putting a little bit of blues in all of my darker colors and a little bit of yellows in all of my lighter colors. So as I get closer and closer to white, I'm actually putting more and more yellow in it, because that's actually how how light works is the shadows tend to be more blue and the highlights tend to be more yellow if you're paying close enough attention. So that's what I'm doing here. Once the dry brushing is complete, I'm just gonna throw a nice wash over top of all of it. Black wash kind of brings everything together. After the wash is all dry, which takes a little bit of time because it is a little bit liquidy, we're going to be doing another overbrush with a nice medium gray. So not as highlighty as the highlights, because I actually think I went a little bit over on the highlights, so close to that highlight color, and it's gonna be more of an overbrush. We're trying to really bring the gray tone into a little bit more of a flat space rather than letting it just kind of have a touch of highlights here and there. So we're kind of bringing all of those colors now, compacting back together so it is more of a flat gray with still detail in there. There's tons of detail, but we want to make it so it's not as detail-y. The next step is to add in some detail so we don't just have flat gray blocks of concrete. We're going to start out with some cracks. I use some black, or it's not actually black. It's actually the color closest to the darkest darks on the actual piece of concrete that we have here. I'm going to be painting those in a somewhat chaotic crack-like order. If you want, please use a reference, take a look at other what cracks look like. From there, I draw in all my cracks, and then I go and I add a little bit of highlight again with about the lightest gray on the model as well, and then paint that on from the top down, so it would be below the cracks, as though the light is shining down on it. Next, we move into some hazard striping. You see these in construction sites or on blocks that are really blocking roads. We're gonna be masking it off, putting a piece of green tape over there, painting it all yellow, and then painting in our black stripes. Then I take some grays and I stipple it in so it looks like it's broken up. We want it to look like it's been used a little bit because these are ideally something that's been on the battlefield for a while. Unfortunately, at this point, I lost the rest of the footage for any of this, so you're gonna have to take my word that you just keep adding a little bit of grays, gonna add a little bit of yellows, a little bit of blacks, and eventually you get to some nice broken up lines. And this is the final product. If you want to use these for your game, they are very handy, very easy, and extremely durable, I've learned, because I've thrown these in a box and taken them around, and they don't chip, they don't break, they are really quite good. Anyways, that's it. Until next time, my name is Adrian, this is Giant Monster Games, thanks for watching, and don't forget to game like a respectable player that understands that because your opponent's losing, they might be a little bit grouchy sometimes.